Hello, Hilton Head. Disappointed that I can't be with you tonight. I really appreciate the organizers making it possible for me to at least say a few words to you rather than being there in person. Hurricane Ian has made a lot of people's lives a little bit more complicated, including mine. Ian is the latest devastating hurricane to confirm that coastal areas are really failing to keep new development and redevelopment out of highly vulnerable areas. Local emergency managers know all too well which places in their communities should not be built back after a storm, but they are rebuilt because the federal government and the states provide multiple incentives to rebuild rather than relocate. The assumption is that taxpayers will always be there to back up private investment after even predictable natural hazards. Manaloke, New Jersey was the poster child in 2012 for Superstorm Sandy's destructiveness. The barrier island that the borough sits on was ripped in half. Homes were destroyed. Even the areas of greatest destruction were rebuilt. We know it will happen again. The money for such rebuilding comes largely through the public assistance sections of the 1988 Stafford Act. This legislation created the federal system of emergency response. When the president makes a federal disaster declaration for a county, aid dollars flow in with few strings attached. Outside of disaster aid, billions of dollars a year are spent by the federal government on resilience projects. The Bipartisan Infrastructure Act of 2021 allowed some $47 billion over several years for resiliency. Most of the funded projects are designed to protect existing infrastructure, and in most cases with no demands for the recipients to improve long-term planning for disasters or change patterns of future floodplain development. Federal and state taxpayers have spent billions of dollars over the past four decades pumping up beaches in front of coastal properties in what are known as beach nourishment projects. In Florida alone, some $3 billion in public funds has been spent just to keep beaches in front of investment homes and oceanfront infrastructure. Studies in Florida have shown that these beach projects increase oceanfront development. Government spending is incentivizing this expansion into danger zones, a classic example of moral hazard, in which there is no reason to protect against risk when the government or federally subsidized flood insurance is there to pick up the tab. I'm not callous about storm relief. There are many people who need help in Ian's aftermath, and the first order of business must be ensuring they get that assistance. But a national conversation is long overdue about the dollars we invest in rebuilding coastal resort communities and what we should expect in return. At the moment, taxpayers are getting little back from these investments. The federal funds come with few restrictions at the local level to provide meaningful adaptation to future sea level rise and intensifying storms. I frequently speak to community groups that ask me what the first step should be for adapting to sea level rise and storm impacts. My answer is simple. The easiest way to limit damage and loss of life is not to create new vulnerabilities. In Charleston, South Carolina, the city is considering asking for more than $1 billion to build an 8-mile-long seawall to protect infrastructure. At the same time, the city has approved a development on what is largely Guggenheim family land to place thousands of new structures in the floodplain. To me, that's a problem. It really shouldn't be like this. Taxpayers should not be subsidizing the risk of irresponsible development, and we clearly shouldn't be rebuilding areas of known hazards multiple times. We need to encourage meaningful coastal adaptation to storms and sea level rise. At the very least, we need to demand that communities accepting public funds for rebuilding or resilience stop putting new infrastructure in harm's way. Hurricane Ian is a chance to change the calculus in Florida. Let's hope that federal, state, and local government can come together to rebuild infrastructure in a way that will reduce future vulnerability and limit taxpayer exposure. There are some places from which we need to pull back. For instance, should we rebuild all the areas of Fort Myers Beach, Florida, that were wiped away by storm surge? Communities are often reluctant to give up even a small portion of their tax base. Some also incorrectly believe that, as the saying goes, if the first row of homes goes, we're all doomed. It's not true. They will spend money on protection until the bitter end. We should walk away from the most vulnerable areas of our oceanfront and spend the money saved on buttressing the more sustainable parts of the community. We should walk away from the most vulnerable areas of our oceanfront and spend the money saved on buttressing the more sustainable parts of our community. We should be demanding this approach in the allocation of federal funds. This is not about abandoning the coastal economy. This is how we preserve it.